I'm Jill, one of the associate vicars here, and it's lovely to have you join us for worship today. This weekend is the second Sunday of Easter, the first Sunday after Easter, and our worship continues celebrating the risen Lord Jesus Christ. We're going to begin our service by reminding ourselves of why we've come together to worship. We are worshiping together, wherever we are, as the family of God in our Father's presence, to offer him praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive his holy word, to bring before him the needs of the world, to ask his forgiveness of our sins, and to seek his grace, that through his Son Jesus Christ we may give ourselves to his service. Amen. And so we're going to sing praise to the risen Lord Jesus in the song, What a Wonderful Name It Is, the Name of Jesus.
You are the Word at the beginning, one with God the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you, our Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. You didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. Now what could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus.
The sweetest name, the name of Jesus. So much power in his name. You are lifting high, Lord. Cause death could not hold you. The veil tore before you. You silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring the praise of your glory. For you are
powerful What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. You have no rival. You have no equal. Now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom. Yours is the glory. Yours is the stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus.
And now we come to a time of confession. We're going to pause and recognize our sin, our failing, our wrongdoings, our shortcomings, the people we've wronged, sharp words we've spoken, selfish thoughts we've entertained, resentments and unforgiveness we've held in our hearts. These may have been hidden or public, dramatic or quite subtle. And they include our wrongdoings individually and together as a society. We're going to have a moment of quiet to bring to mind any such things we might want to say sorry to God for this morning. And then we're going to pray the confession together and hear the assurance of his forgiveness. So let's confess. Please join with me the words on the screen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. So may the God of love and power forgive us and free us from our sins, heal and strengthen us by his Spirit, and raise us to new life in Christ our Lord. Amen. As God's forgiven people, we listen to his word, and today's Bible reading is from John chapter 20. This is Jesus appearing to his disciples after the resurrection. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when the Lord Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. stop doubting and believe. Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and have believed." Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book, but these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Let's pray. May the power of the risen Jesus be real in our lives. Amen. Thomas is the most famous doubter of the resurrection. He has, I think, rather unfairly been nicknamed Doubting Thomas. But whether this label is fair or unfair, the story of his doubts can be very helpful to us today. In the modern day, many people find it hard to believe in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. I remember once talking to a colleague at work, at a work party, and the topic turned to faith. And I remember a look of incredulity when I said that I believed in the resurrection of Jesus. I could almost see her thinking, how could this seemingly intelligent and reasonable person believe in something like that? Is it possible to believe in the resurrection of Jesus Christ in today's world? Will Thomas give us help in answering this question? Many of us here are Christians and we do believe in the resurrection, but I suspect that some of you, like me, harbour doubt and uncertainty at times. In the face of troubles, illness and death, we may not feel so convinced. I believe that for us, seeing how Thomas moved from doubt to faith can be helpful. And there may be some of us who don't believe in the resurrection of Jesus, and I hope that the story of Thomas will be an encouragement for you to consider whether the resurrection could be true after all. I'm going to look at whether this account of Thomas helps us by asking two questions. One, why didn't Thomas believe, i.e., why was he so sceptical? And two, how did he come to believe? I'm not going to spend long on the first question because the text doesn't tell us and it's speculative. But the speculation may be helpful because while we can't be sure about Thomas, as we speculate, we're likely to cover at least some of the reasons why people today find it so hard to believe in the resurrection. One possible reason is that he was a sceptical type of person. Some people really want lots of evidence before they'll accept something as true. They want to see solid, undisputed facts. In contrast, some people are more intuitive. They rely more on perception and instinct. Some of us find it hard to believe unless we see concrete evidence. And if that's your approach, rather than a more intuitive one, then you can look at Thomas and say, yes, he represents me. Another possibility is that Thomas was sceptical of the supernatural. He might have said in his head, dead people don't come back to life. Many of us take the view that dead people don't come back to life and find it hard to believe in miracles. People with a sceptical view of the supernatural will find it hard to believe in the resurrection. Now, that may not have been Thomas's problem. After all, he had seen many miracles, including Jesus raising Lazarus from the dead. But many people today do find it hard to believe in miracles. It may not have been Thomas's problem, but it may be our problem. A third possible reason is that Thomas was afraid that it was too good to be true. There's a saying, it's the hope that kills. You're in a bad situation and hope that things will get better. But they don't, and your hopes are dashed, and the disappointment is crushing. You might think it would have been better never to have hoped in the first place. And Thomas might have been afraid of having his hopes raised and then cruelly dashed. And these are some of the reasons why we may find it hard to believe in the resurrection. One, you may be someone who needs lots of evidence. Two, you may find it hard to believe in miracles. After all, dead people don't usually come back to life. Or three, you may be feeling, I'm afraid of being drawn into something that seems too good to be true, and then being devastated when I discover it is indeed too good to be true. For all these reasons and others, whoever we are, we may see ourselves in Thomas. Thomas, the great doubter, said in the end, my Lord and my God. It's striking that he doesn't simply say, wow, you're alive again. He says, my Lord and my God. For a Jewish man to say that to a human being is the highest confession of faith possible. Thomas moved from 0 to 60 in double quick time. The resurrection is a crucial part of the Christian message. As St. Paul wrote to the Corinthians, and if Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless, and so is your faith. So, following Thomas's example, how can we calm our doubts about the resurrection? I'm going to suggest three ways that may be helpful. One way is to listen to the witnesses of the resurrection. A second is to look at the wounds of Jesus. And a third is to drop our conditions. So first, let's listen to the eyewitnesses. Verses 19 to 24 of our Gospel reading from John chapter 20 tells us, after the resurrection, that Jesus appeared to the disciples in a particular room, and Thomas wasn't there. In verse 26, we're told that 1 week later, Jesus appeared again, and this time, Thomas was there. So what had happened in that week? Verse 25 says that the disciples had kept on telling him again and again, we have seen the Lord. And Thomas replied, I just can't believe it. The eyewitnesses were talking to Thomas. Now, Thomas was in a similar position to you and me. Thomas had access to eyewitness accounts of people who had seen the risen Jesus. Now, Thomas's eyewitnesses' accounts were from people who were alive. We have eyewitness accounts of the same events, but in our case, they are written down because the Gospels are eyewitness accounts of the apostles and their companions. So, can we trust these accounts? A lot of scholarly research has argued that the Gospels do not sound like fiction writing. Instead, they sound like eyewitness accounts, oral testimony. In ancient times, when you recorded events, To vouch for their authenticity, you named eyewitnesses who could back up your account. These eyewitnesses needed to be alive to enable people to check your story with them. Some 20 years later, in 1 Corinthians 15, Paul wrote about these events, the events of the resurrection, the post-resurrection events. He said that Jesus Christ appeared to 500 people at once, most of whom were still alive. Paul's in effect saying, if you don't believe me, ask them. Paul could not possibly have written this unless there really were eyewitnesses. Jesus says, actually, these eyewitness accounts is all you should need, all we should need. Because in verse 29 he says, blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. In his graciousness, Jesus did appear to Thomas, but we don't need that. How many things in history do we believe in that we didn't see? About 99.999%. Do we believe that William the Conqueror invaded England in 1066 and defeated King Harold at the Battle of Hastings? Yes, we do. No serious historian doubts the existence of Julius Caesar or Alexander the Great, although they lived over 2,000 years ago. We believe all kinds of things in history on the basis of eyewitness accounts. If we want to believe in the resurrection, then let's read the Gospels and keep on reading the Gospels. Read them as you would read eyewitness accounts and see how they stand up. Let's listen, let's hear the eyewitnesses to Jesus. And secondly, let's look at the wounds of Jesus. Jesus appears to Thomas and tells Thomas that he can touch him and feel his wounds. But Thomas doesn't. Instead, he declares in awe, "My Lord and my God." So why didn't Thomas touch Jesus as invited? The obvious reason is that Thomas thought that the wounds were sufficient evidence that Jesus was indeed alive. When he saw the wounds, he believed that Jesus had risen from the dead. So he didn't actually need to feel the wounds in Jesus' side. But Jesus' wounds actually signify something much more powerful than evidence that Jesus is alive. Vitally important, though that is. Why would a resurrected body have wounds in it? This is supposed to be a body not subject to death. So if you get a perfect resurrection body, why would there be wounds in it? If we believe we'll get a resurrection body, well, there are a lot of things in our present body that we wouldn't want in a resurrection body. Jesus told Thomas to look at his wounds. Now, Thomas, like all his fellow disciples, had seen those wounds inflicted on Jesus. He had seen Jesus on the cross. He had seen the nails go into Jesus' hands, and he had seen the spear go into Jesus' side. And when the disciples saw those wounds being inflicted, they thought that meant all their hopes were being destroyed. As well as killing Jesus, those wounds were wrecking everything that they had hoped for in the future. Of course, Jesus actually comes back and says to them, "You thought that the wounds that I suffered were destroying your hopes and ruining your lives. But instead, they have in effect saved your lives. It's my wounds on the cross that have brought you forgiveness. I died so that your sins might be forgiven. What seemed to be the worst and most terrible thing that could have happened to Jesus brought him glory and the ultimate defeat of evil in our lives. The wounds are not only evidence that Jesus is alive, but also evidence that Jesus loves us. The wounds weren't just saying, "Look at me, look at what I've done for you," but they were saying, "Look at how much I love you." And that point broke through to Thomas. He realized what Jesus had done for him and declared, "My Lord and my God." Listen to the eyewitness accounts. Look at Jesus' wounds. And thirdly, drop our conditions. Drop our conditions. Another reason why Thomas might not have touched Jesus' wounds, that he realized at that moment that he had actually said, "I will not believe unless, I will only believe if." Often when we move towards Jesus, it's because we want something. We've got conditions. "I want to follow you, Jesus, but please don't expect me to forgive the person who wronged me. Or please don't ask me to give away even more of my money. Or please don't ask me to be gracious to people I disagree with or to call out my friend's racism." When we impose conditions, we are saying to Jesus, "I will love you if." Jesus didn't love us conditionally. The Bible says that while we were yet God's enemies, he died for us. His love is unconditional. He looks into our lives, into our hearts, and yet he still loves us. He sees all our flaws, yet he still died for us. He has looked into our lives and has loved us unconditionally. So how can we come to him and say, "We're going to follow him," but at the same time impose conditions on our discipleship? Listen to the eyewitnesses, look at his wounds, and drop our conditions. To know the power of the resurrection in this life is an astounding assurance and promise. The late Archbishop of Cape Town, Desmond Tutu, summed up the power of the resurrection and Easter as follows. "Easter says to us that despite everything to the contrary, his will for us will prevail. Love will prevail over hate, justice over injustice and oppression, peace over exploitation and bitterness." Let's pray. Lord, make the resurrection real to us. Help it to inspire and change the way we live each day beyond Easter. Make us bringers of your hope. Amen.
And now we come to pray for others, our intercessions. As we gather here with God's presence in the midst of us, let us pray. We bring to you, Lord, the church in all its richness and in all its need, all its diversity and all its division. Give us a fresh understanding of what it means to live for you. May all of us celebrate the reality of your presence among us, filling us with new life and new hope. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We bring to you, Lord, our nation, our world, our universe, all the areas that are fastened shut to hold you out, all the bewildered confusion about who we are and why we are here, all the doubts and insecurity, and all the searching for inner peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We bring to you, Lord, our homes and families and all the joys and sorrows of our relationships. We bring the rooms in which we eat and work and relax and invite you into them all. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We bring to you, Lord, those whom life has damaged and all who find it difficult to trust in you. We bring you those who need refreshment and hope, comfort, healing and inner serenity. Especially we pray for those we know who are unwell, including Cyril, Winnie, Claire, Emily, Jennifer, Laura, Lola, Frank, Rodney, Bruce, Natalie, Jessica, Alex, Penny, Daphne, Amit, Anne, Eileen and Glenda. And we pray for all who mourn, including the loss of Zach, Colin, Elsa, Annabel, Penny, Lorna, Maria, Daniel, Sharon and Tony. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We bring to you, Lord, those who approach death with great fear and those who die unprepared to meet you. Have mercy on us all, forgive us all that is past, and gather us into your everlasting kingdom of peace and joy. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We bring to you, Lord, the love of our hearts as we recall the extent of your great love for us, which understands our frailty and reaches out to us where we are. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We finish with the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And so we sing again another great hymn of praise, How Great Thou Art.
I
the end of our service together. I really would encourage you to take a look at our parish website to see all of the things that are going on this week and in the coming weeks. So for an Easter blessing. May the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and all those you love, now and always. Amen. Bye-bye. See you again soon. Thank you.